If you have your Bibles, open up to the book of Job. If you're new in the Lord, you probably call it Job, the book of Job. But it's Job. Actually, Job is, as far as our Bible is concerned, the Protestant Bible, it's the oldest book in the Bible. So it's an old, old book. And if you have that book, open up to Job, the second chapter. Let me read the text for you. We're talking about angels here. Not men and women, sons of God, but angels. Beginning with the second chapter, let me read about 10 verses. Again, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. And Satan came also among them to present himself before the Lord. And the Lord said to Satan, "From where do you come?" So Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro on the earth and from walking back and forth on it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth? A blameless and upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil. And still he holds fast to his integrity, although you incited me against him to destroy him without cause." That's what Satan's job is. So Satan answered the Lord and said, "Skin for skin. Yes, all that a man has, he will give for his life. But stretch out your hand now, and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will surely curse you to your face." And the Lord said to Satan, "Behold, he is in your hand, but spare his life." So no matter how insidious Satan is, he still answers to God. And so God is about to allow a test to take place in the life of Job. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and struck Job with painful boils from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. And he took himself a potsherd, in other words, a piece of broken pottery, with which to scrape himself while he sat in the midst of the ashes. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still hold fast to your integrity? Curse God and die." Sometimes the very people that you count on the most can fail you. "Shall we indeed accept good from God, and shall we not accept adversity? In all this, Job did not sin with his lips." Now, I'm not going to imply here today, I'm not about to try to make a point that we like trouble. Nobody likes trouble. Unfortunately, we're all faced with trouble almost constantly. I mean, I don't want to get off into negativism this morning, but, you know, there's no guarantees that we have 1 hour left today. So trouble is probably the closest thing to most of us every day of our lives. We don't want trouble, we don't like trouble, but trouble is inevitable. And what this book is about, it's about the hardships that this man Job experiences. He's extremely wealthy. He loses it all. houses, lands, gold. He's blessed abundantly with children. He loses them all as you go through this book. And then his friends begin to flock around him. And it's not bad enough, but they blame him for anything and everything. Be careful. Be careful when someone's going through hard times. Be careful of doing what these friends did. Oh, it's because you're a sinner. You sinned. And that's basically the position that they all were coming from. But what we learn in this book, what we learn from it, is that although Job experiences major, major hardships, we see that his commitment to God, now he questions God. He'll say, I don't quite understand why this is going on, why this is happening. But his commitment to God never changes. And so what is the benefit? When we read this book, what is the thing we learn the most? That I think is that there can be benefits from trials. We don't like trials, but we learn from trials. We learn to develop empathy or sympathy. We learn to use what God has given us for the benefit of others. All of a sudden, we realize, wait a minute, I've been blessed. Now I can bless others. By the way, that's the key benefit of blessing. People say, why? What's the benefit of blessing? What's the purpose? To bless others. And this is the key to acquiring. When you bless others, you get blessed. Give and it will be given unto you. So we need to look and see, what can I benefit? What way can I benefit by going through these trials and tribulations? You may develop patience. You may be able to get anger under control for the very first time in your life. You might even be able to admit you have an anger problem for the very first time in your life. What we learn in those first 10 verses is that, in a sense, there's a trial. There's something being dreamt up between God and the highest angel, Satan, Lucifer, light bearer. Again, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. And that's what he does. He's an accuser of the brethren. He's got all kinds of titles. He's a thief. He's a liar. He's a robber. But he also is an accuser. I mean, he's ever around to remind you of your failures. And I said this a couple of weeks ago. How we must weary God, reminding God of what he already knows. What is it God doesn't know? There's nothing he doesn't know. Everything. But we're always reminding him that we were a sinner. And then he has to remind us, you're a sinner no more. But we kind of go through these little rituals all the time. So Satan makes a profound statement. He says, yeah, he serves you. Look at him. He's blessed. He's got a large family. He's got all of his wants needed, all of his desires fulfilled. But you let me touch his body, and he will curse you. So what do we learn from this? That Satan is the prosecuting attorney. He loves to torment you. But thank God for this. God is our defense attorney. In 2 Timothy 4:18, it says, "And the Lord will deliver me from every evil work and preserve me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever." Job is just like us, the accused, the accuser and the accused. But there's no difference in what we go through. "Stretch out your hand now, touch his bone and his flesh, and he will surely curse you to your face." And John 10:10 gives us the revelation of Satan. "The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy." This is what Jesus says, "I have come that they may have life, that they may have it more abundantly." So what form does tribulation take? It takes all forms. It can be physical. We've all experienced physical problems in our lives. It can be emotional. Just out of curiosity, how many people are married in here today? Raise your hand. Oh, you can really relate to emotional problems then, okay. And it can be spiritual. But there's truth for the troubled man. Isaiah 54:17 says, No weapon formed against me, or you for that matter, shall prosper, and every tongue which rises against you in judgment, you shall condemn." This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is from me, says the Lord. I like Psalms 119, verse 71. This is what it says, believe it or not. "It is good for me that I have been afflicted, that I may learn your statutes." And I like Romans 8:28, "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose." There's always a purpose. That there's always a reason for the struggles that we're going through. And mainly, it's to minister to people who are going through similar struggles. And you can put into them what you learned when you were going through that. And if Job can do this, we can do this. This was his trump card, so to speak. In Job 2:10, "In all this, Job did not sin with his lips." That's probably the biggest downer in people's lives. We can't keep our mouths shut. We sin with our lips. Psalms 119:16 says, "Great place have those who love your law, and nothing causes them to stumble." I think what's so sad when we equate the weaknesses and failures of our lives, and then we've walked around for years and years saying, "We're born again. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me." And then we cave so easily. What we are really saying is, Christianity was hogwash. The blood of Christ held really no power whatsoever. When we succumb to the most easiest of trials and tribulations, That's the signal flag that goes up. Isaiah 26:3, you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Why would we exchange the things that we have experienced as believers? Blind eyes. I've lived to see this in my day. Blind eyes opened. Tumors eradicated. Waterhead babies, heads shrinking before your very eyes. And yet, today it's like, well, we don't need that Pentecostal stuff. We need more Pentecost today than we've ever needed it before. We went out 2 weeks ago and walked the city of El Monte. Two reasons. One, to bring down the strongholds of hell. I mean, there are all kinds of war zones in a city. And number two, to open up the wells of revival that are still bubbling under your feet. Most of the people that live in their cities, they don't even know anything about their cities. They don't know what happened in the 20s and the 30s. I'm old. There's an advantage to being old. You were around when a lot of that stuff was happening. Charlene and I graduated from a school that I'm going to estimate it had about a 2,000-seat auditorium that they used to hold summer revivals in. The foundations are still there. The waters that bubbled up during those great revival days is still running. Wells last for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. They plug them up. They get plugged up. But like Isaac of old, Isaac redug the wells of his father Abraham. That's what we should be about. Not complaining about what happened, what it used to be. We need to unplug the wells of revival. Schools aren't dead. They need to be revived. When we were on fire walking for this city, Bible clubs were going strong at El Monte and Arroyo and up in Arcadia. Kids were gathering at the flagpoles and praying. I mean, we got two choices today. We can either die in our cities or we can live in our cities. We got that choice today. On fire Christians, people who are interceding, people who are praying. Why is that important? Why do you put such value and stock in that? Because of Isaiah 32:17, the work of righteousness will be peace. I don't understand why all churches and all believers aren't walking their cities, aren't praying over the PowerPoints. Where do you think your children are going to die? In the city that they live in. The advantage of getting old in a ministry like me, you learn one thing. You learn that you bury a lot more young people than you do old people. And the effect of righteousness, quietness, and assurance forever. You want to know, like cities, you'll say, why is this city so affected like this? Or why is a city so affected like that? Go back and check out the roots of your city. Ever since I've been in El Monte, we've dealt with gangs. At the root of this city was one of the worst gangs ever invented by man. They were called the El Monte Boys. And if you disagreed with them, and we don't have Hoyt Avenue anymore, but you probably remember when we had a Hoyt Avenue here. There was a barn down there where the beams were worn slick because if you disagreed with them, they took you down there and hung you. And then when Sepulveda went and raped the Owens Valley for the water for L.A., and there were all kinds of fights going on, dynamiting dams, guess who they sent for? El Monte Boys. Wasn't bad enough that they were here. They took them down to L.A. to fight their battles for them. Ever since, there's over 70,000 gangs fostered all over L.A. County. And we go, wow, wonder where all these gangs come from. El Monte Boys. There was a guy here last week that started out with El Monte Flores when El Monte Flores was brand new. I knew this guy, and he got saved, and he attended our church for years and years. He lives in San Bernardino now, and they were still calling him Patron. So don't tell me we can't reach in to the gangs in our valley and get these guys saved. We can do it. But we got to believe that. Amen. You are on trial. Whether you like it or not, you're on trial. You got to make up your mind that Jesus can cause you to be a true overcomer. Are you going to fold and cave? One or the other. Whatever your profession is, if you're teachers, you got to square your shoulder and you got to stand up and you got to tell it like it is. Pastors, we don't need to be watering it down. We need to be multiplying the ministry. Amen? I never can figure this out. Why the church doesn't know that Satan wants you to fail. He wants you to fail. But God wants you to succeed. So much that He gave His only begotten Son that you might be saved through Jesus Christ, our perfect sacrifice. You can triumph over Satan. We're winners. Amen.